The idols of the heathen are silver and gold, the work of men's hands. They have mouths, but they speak not. Eyes have they, but they see not. They have ears, but they hear not. Neither is there any breath in their mouths. Bless the Lord, ye that fear the Lord. Bless the Lord. Will you please turn with me to the screen for our processional hymn this morning? Bless the name of the Lord.
Blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Name above all names shall stand, exalted more and more. God the Father's own right hand, there's angels host adore. Blessed be the
Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for your love for us. We come to this holy place and stand on this holy ground to stand before you this morning, to worship you and show our love for you because truly you have loved us first. We stand amazed as to why, but because you have chosen us, we are thankful and search to be the joy of your heart and to be pleasing to your sight. We beg you to come to closer and be with us as we search to be the people and place where your love grows for others as it has grown for us. We were in darkness and the void covered us before you laid out your hand to bring order into our lives. We had nothing but just this existence before you sent your Son to die for us on Calvary. And now we have been raised and made heir to your kingdom, to live forever and ever in the heavenly homes you have created for us. How can we not be in awe at the wonder and security of our future? Be with us this morning. Enjoy our song and our praises. You were not ashamed of us when you sent your only Son to die for us. Now we stand together and are not ashamed of you. You are our God, and we are your people. You are blessed, and we bless your holy name. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated as we go to our screen again for our responsive reading. Is from Psalm 72, 17. His name shall endure forever.
His name shall be continued as long as the sun.
Men shall be blessed in him.
All nations shall call him blessed.
Amen. Bless the reading of God's word. Our praise song this morning is Bless His Holy Name. Our memory verse, still from Romans 3:10, as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. Who can do that without looking at the screen? Romans 3:10. Good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to see everyone here this morning. It was supposed to be a rainy morning, but it hasn't been. We've even seen the sun come out a couple times. So we want to welcome all of you that are watching us from home. And we're glad that you are here this morning and in our sanctuary and watching. It's truly is a blessing that we can reach out to you at your homes. And I know that sometimes it seems that, you know, we don't know. I guess, you know, one of the things that I would like to know is sometimes I hear from people that watch us, or all of a sudden somebody will come up and say that they're watching us. But we don't know who's watching or how many people are watching. It would be nice once in a while for someone to, or, you know, to send us a letter. I do get emails once in a while, but if you're watching, please let us know how how we're doing. And I promise, you know, that if you write me or email me, I'm not going to put your name on a mailing list. I'm not going to send it out to anybody else. You're not going to be bothered by a lot of, you know, things. But I would like to hear from you. One of the reasons that I would like to hear from people, too, is see how we're doing. And also, if you need prayer, if you need me as a pastor to be pastorly in your life as well. So we look forward every week to you being a part of our worship service. I'll give you our all of our addresses and that. If you want to write us, and I hope that you do, we can get a hold of us at Community Bible Church, P.O. Box 41, Titusville, 16354. And if you need to pick us up on the internet, you can get us at cbc.tville@yahoo.com. And you can also go to Community Bible Church at our Facebook page, right? And just Community Bible Church at our Facebook page. And we're on there. And yesterday we had our first family reunion here in our new fellowship hall. So eventually we'll start having pictures on our Facebook page of all the things going on around here. It's kind of slowed down a little bit because of the rain. We got some of the fence up this week, and the rain kind of kept us from getting the rest of it up. Now we're going to have to wait till it dries up. But we did get the material to put the screen in the back. We've got one area that we put back there, and we put the gravel down so people can go in. I mean, we're almost right after it rains. You can be there and use the picnic tables. And back there, we're putting a big screen up so that we can have Friday night movie night, or some night movie night anyway. And so we're going to try to get that screen up this week. And so if you have kids or people that are interested in being a part of that, or part of a youth group, or would like to come out, please let us know. And you can call us at, if I can get the, I'm on, but it's not moving, at 967-3628. You can call us at 967-3628 if you have somebody that wants to be a part. We have a bus, and we look forward to being able to pick people up, bring people out to church, bring people out to youth groups, and any of the other things that we have going on. Wednesday night, we had a great Bible study. We had 15 here for Bible study Wednesday night, and had a wonderful time. So we've, even though the rain has been terrible and it's been miserable times, you know, we've had you know, some good times out here in Alaska. We had a puppet show yesterday, and then a family reunion later because their place got rained out and ours didn't. I don't know how that worked out, but thankfully we've been preparing for that. Maybe that's been the purpose for all the rain, is so that we can solve all those rain problems. You know, I don't know. Are the animals still down under the down under here? Because I tell you, I could imagine two emus coming up to me yesterday and saying, "Isn't this where they're building the ark?" Working out there, but I told him that the lumber was for a playground, not the ark. So please get in touch with us. We would like very much to be part of your family. We know that there are many people, many of you that watch us every week, and you've made us a part of your family, and we appreciate that very much. We want to thank the stream and Armstrong Cable for helping us do this. The Armstrong Cable provides the time. We couldn't pay for the time, but they provide the time. They dedicate that time for all the churches, and then we pay the stream for the production and putting this out. So we want to thank both of them for that. And we also, besides the other things that are going on, we have Wednesday night, even last Wednesday night, we had a few kids here. We got a fire going, and we had a picnic after a bonfire. So if you want to come out Wednesday nights at 7 o'clock, 6 o'clock is Bible study, 7 o'clock is usually where we get together. We have a bonfire, and the kids have a good time, and we'll make s'mores and cook hot dogs and do all kinds of other things. And we're still looking for donations for our playground and for Kramer equipment and whatever. So if you want to be a bigger part of us, we encourage you to do that. Well, may I ask you please come forward for our tithes and offerings. Will you please rise? Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for all that you have given us. We thank you for everything that we have. We thank you for our church and our families, our homes, and we ask you to bless this offering, to bless each and every person, bless their offering, their giving, their time, their energy, all the things that everyone does here to help grow this church. Help us to grow, to reach all the people around us. Help us to be all that we can be, to spread your love. In Jesus' name and for his sake we pray. Amen. You may be seated. As I ask, are there praises this morning? God working miracles and wonders in your life.
And I wanted to praise the Lord that my family got here safely and that, you know, we had a wonderful time to spend together.
Good, yes. And so, yes, it truly is a praise that as miserable as the weather was yesterday, we still had a nice place here and even had room for the kids to play a little bit, yeah. And we're trying to make that more, get some more room for the kids to play. And so... Yeah, praise the Lord for that. Anyone else this morning? Have a praise.
I don't want to thank the Lord that they got rained out, but I do want to thank the Lord that they got to come here, because then we got invited for supper.
Okay. Jane, your hand was up.
I just want to thank the Lord for getting Tripp and Brittany and I here this morning, and for blessing me with their presence and helping me with breakfast this morning.
Good. Yes, I know. Brittany and Tripp are being big helps, and you know, and we really appreciate. And that's a praise too. It's always, and that's great.
It's a special time,
I think. That breakfast time that we started. It is a special time, and we encourage you if you're watching at home and you're passing by. You know, to come in 9:10 to 9:50, that we have this little special time that we have breakfast, and you can come out and share breakfast with us. And maybe some people are passing, going on to another church. Well, you can stop in here and have breakfast with us too. So, any other praises this morning? God working miracles in your life. How about prayer requests? For, yes, Linda's family's traveling back home. And, okay. Jane's mom. And then Sarah's supposed to be coming back this week, right?
Tuesday.
What day?
Tuesday.
Tuesday, all right. So, and then we're praying, You know, with all the rain and everything, we've really put a lot of finances and effort into the field. We've had to put drain. We've had to do a lot of extra stuff that we couldn't do. So we need to pray that we can finish that, because I had kids come to me and say, are we still going to have a playground? Are we still going to play ball out there? Are we still going to? And I'm desperately trying to do that, but we're running really tight on funds for that. But if we can, hopefully and prayerfully. But we're starting to get the fence up, and I praise God that we are, even in the difficulty, that we're making a little bit of progress. Every week we come here, there's something changed, and a little bit of progress moving forward. So I praise God for that. How about let's go to the Lord in prayer then. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love for us, and we thank you that you have planted us here in this country. We ask you to watch over the leadership of this country and bring them closer to you. We know that we live in the end times, and we look forward to you sending your Son Jesus Christ at any moment. We know things are not going to get better, but Lord, we pray that the remnant in this country will grow. We pray that people will come to salvation, and people will realize that they need to turn to you, or they're going to be left behind. We know that even though we pray for this country and this world, that terrible things are going to happen, such as the plane being shot down, and we pray for those families, and we pray for the families in Israel that are going through the difficult time being bombed and rocketed by Gaza. It's hard to come up with the right answer when you're dealing with so much hatred. Lord, we ask you to remove us completely from all of that around here. For your Son, Jesus Christ, came with only love in his heart, love for all mankind to find salvation. Help us to reach people, because we know that Jesus did not die for the universal brotherhood of man, but that he died so that each of us would have the opportunity to make a choice, and that each of us must make that choice. Help us be the church that helps people make that choice, that spreads the gospel so people will hear. Help us to grow and be all that we can be. Be with our military as they serve this country and keep us safe and strong. We ask you to be with Linda's family who is traveling back and forth. And we ask you to be with Jane's mom. I ask you to keep your hand upon Dee Dee and all of her family and all the things that are going on there. To be with Sarah as she travels back on Tuesday. And certainly it will be a praise when she comes home, as she is sorely missed as well. We ask you to be with those who are not here this morning, with John and Nancy, and we ask you to keep your hand upon them and watch over them. We ask you to keep your hand upon the bus, as we need to send the bus for its inspection this week, and just keep your hand upon our finances and watch over us and guide us and help us reach out to be with all of our families. Lord, I thank you so much for all of the dedication from all of this congregation, for the help that I receive and that we receive, and the love that is spread out here. It always amazes me, Lord. There's always love in this congregation for everyone and everyone who shows up. Watch over us and guide us. Help us be all that we can be. For it's in Jesus' name and for his sake we pray. Amen. Well, eventually we'll learn a few Hebrew words, right? Baruch Hashem Adonai, blessed be the name of the Lord. Adonai always is Hebrew for God or the Lord. My scripture this morning, again, we're going to continue on with Galatians 3, and we're going to finish the third chapter of Galatians. We're going to start with verse 15, where we left off, through 29. So if you have your Bibles, turn with me, Galatians 3, 15 through 29. Remember, Paul is preaching to, or writing this letter to the Galatians. Brethren, I speak, and he's talking about justification. Brethren, I speak after the manner of men. Though it be but a man's covenant, yet if it be confirmed, no man disannulleth or addeth thereto. Now, to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He said not, or God said not, and to seeds. If you go back to Genesis, God said that Abraham's seed, and it was singular, and this is what Paul is emphasizing, that God didn't say to your seeds, but he said it to your seed, as of many, but rather as of one, and to thy seed, which is Christ. And this I say, that the covenant that was confirmed before of God in Christ, the law, which was 430 years after, cannot disannul, that it should make the promise of none effect. For if the inheritance be of the law, it is no more of promise. But God gave it to Abraham by promise. Remember that God gave Abraham this by promise, not by law. Wherefore then serveth the law? It was added because of transgressions, till the seed should come to whom the promise was made, and it was ordained by angels in the hand of a mediator. Now a mediator is not a mediator of one, but God is one. Is the law then against the promise of God? God forbid. For if there had been a law given which could have given life, verily righteousness should have been by the law. But the Scriptures hath concluded all under sin, that the promise by faith of Jesus Christ might be given to them that believe. But before faith came, we were kept under the law, shut up unto the faith which should afterwards be revealed. Wherefore the law was our schoolmaster to bring us into Christ, that we might be justified by faith. But after that faith is come, we are no longer under a schoolmaster, for ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither bond nor free. There is neither male nor female. For ye are all one in Christ Jesus. And if ye be Christ, then are ye Abraham's seed, and heirs according to that promise. If you find that somebody living back under the law, even today, at any time, if you know of anybody that was ever lived under the law, and he was saved by keeping the law, would you please write me a note and let me know and give me that person's name? I have never read of anyone who has ever been saved by the law, by keeping the Mosaic law. It's not possible. And as you know, the heart of the Mosaic system was the sacrificial system. Moses rejoiced that God could extend mercy and grace to people even under the law. That is the reason his face shone as it did. Remember when Moses came down, his face was shiny. And he was shiny because he was happy, he was glad. And Habakkuk 2:14, it says that the just shall live by his faith. Faith and law are contrary principles for salvation and also for living. One cancels out the other. They are diametrically opposed to each other. If you are going to live by the law, then you cannot be saved by faith. You cannot combine them. they are contrary. Now, we have many people today in all kinds of denominations trying to live by works. And when works and the law, doing that, and sin, not sinning, being good people, good enough to go to heaven, this is what we're talking about, being under the law. You're trying to earn your way to salvation by being a good person. And that cannot happen because nobody's ever done it. You can't combine faith. You can't be, partially have part faith and part living by being a good person, because they are contrary. Let me explain by giving this illustration. One time I tried to get a train route from Ohio to California without going through Chicago, because I didn't want to go through Chicago. It was impossible. So I went instead by plane. When I got the ticket, I said, wouldn't it be nice if I could go by train and plane at the same time? Sit in the plane and put my feet down in the train. But that's totally absurd. If we go by plane, we go by plane. If we go by train, we go by train. They have made no arrangements for passengers to sit in a plane and put his feet down in a train. Neither has God any arrangements for you to be saved by faith and by the law. You have to choose one or the other. If you want to go by law, then you can try it. But I warn you that God has already said you won't make it. The law is not of faith, but the man that doeth them shall live in them. Christ was made a curse for us. The question is, when did Christ become a curse? Did he become a curse in his incarnation? Oh no. When he was born, he was called that holy thing in Luke. Did he become a curse during those silent years of which we have so little record? No. It says that he advanced in favor with God and man. Did he become a curse during his ministry? No, again. It was during his ministry that the Father said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." Then he must have become a curse while he was on the cross. He must have become a curse during that time. But not during the first 3 hours on the cross. Because when he offered up himself, he was without blemish. It was during those last 3 hours on the cross that he was made a curse for us. It was then that it pleased the Lord to bruise him and to put him to grief. He made his soul an offering for sin. God made a promise, a covenant with Abraham. When the law came along 430 years after that promise, it didn't change anything as far as the promise made to Abraham was concerned. Actually, God never goes back on his promises. God's not an Indian giver. And that's, you know, I have discussions with people about this, you know, that. But God isn't an Indian. He never gives something. He never gives a promise and then takes it back. God promised Abraham, "I am going to give you this land. I am going to give you a son and a people that will be numberless as the sand on the seashore." God fulfilled that promise and brought from Abraham the nation of Israel and several other nations. But the promises were given through Isaac, whose line led to the Lord Jesus Christ, the seed of verse 16. God also promised Abraham that he would make him a blessing to all people. The only blessing in this world today is in Jesus Christ. You may not get a very good deal from your neighbor or from your business or from your church. I don't think the world is prepared to give you a good deal. But the Lord Jesus Christ has been giving to you that is a good deal. In fact, it is the supreme gift which God has made. It is a fulfillment of God's promise that he would save those who would trust Christ. Now listen to Paul as he talks about the purpose of the law. "Wherefore then serveth the law? It was added because of transgressions, till the seed should come to whom the promise was made, and it was ordained by angels in the hand of the mediator. The question is, wherefore then serveth the law? Paul is giving a purpose sentence. What was the purpose of the law? Paul says it was something that was added. It was added because, or better still, for the sake of transgression. The law was added. Remember, the promise came first, but the law was added. Till the seed should come. That little word, till, is an important time word. It means the law was temporary. The law was given for the interval between the time of Moses until the time of Christ. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. It is very important to see that the law was temporary until the seed should come. And that seed is Christ. The law was added because of, or for the sake of, transgressions. It was given to remove, or to reveal, not remove sin. It was not given to keep man from sin, because sin had already come. It was to show man himself as being a natural, ugly, crude sinner before God. Any man who is honest will look at himself in the light of the law and see himself guilty. It was not given to prove that all men were sinners, nor was it given as a standard by which man becomes holy. You can't use the law as a standard by which you become holy. You would never become holy this way because, first of all, you can't keep the law in your own strength. Many people think that man becomes a sinner when he commits a sinful act, that he is all right until he breaks down and commits sin. This is not true. It is because he is already a sinner that a man commits an act of sin. A man steals because he is a thief. A man lies because he is a liar. And the law was given to show that we are sinners and that you and I need a mediator, one to stand between us and God. One to help us out. Is the law then against the promises of God? The expression God forbid means certainly not. Why? If there had been another way of saving us sinners, God would have used that way. If he could have given a law by which sinners could be saved, he would have done so. But the scripture hath concluded, all are under sin, that the promise of faith of Jesus Christ might be given to them that believe. We have seen that the law brought death. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. The scripture has concluded all are under sin. Therefore, all must die. What is needed, therefore, is life. We have seen that the law brings death, which is all that it can do. It is not actually the degree of sin, but the mere fact of sin that brings death. Hence, all are equally dead and equally in need. You may not have committed as great a sin as Stalin committed, but you and I have the same kind of nature that he had. In fact, it was Goethe, the great German writer, who made this statement, "I have never seen a crime committed, but what I might have committed that crime." He recognized that he had that kind of a nature. It is not the degree of sin, but the very fact that we are sinners that brings death. Let me illustrate this fact of sin and not the degree. Picture a building about 24 stories high. There are three men on top of the building, and a superintendent goes up, you know, to warn them about being on top of the building. "Now, be very careful," he says. "Don't step off this building or you will be killed. It will mean death for you." One of the guys up on the roof, one of the fellows, says, "This crazy superintendent is always trying to frighten people. I don't believe that if I step off this building, I will die." So he deliberately walks to the edge of the building and steps off into the air. Supposing that when he passes the 10th floor, somebody looks out the window and asks, "Well, how's it going?" And he says, well, so far, so good. But he hasn't arrived yet. There is death at the bottom. The superintendent was right. The man is killed. Now suppose the second fellow becomes frightened at what the superintendent said. And he becomes so scared that he runs to the elevator and slips, and accidentally slips right off the edge of the building. He skids right off and falls to the street below. He too is killed. The third fellow, we'll say, is thrown off the building by some gangsters who come up there, and they're angry, and they've been chasing him, and they grab him, and they throw him off the building. And surely, when he hits the ground, he's killed too. Now, the man who was thrown off the building is just as dead as the man who deliberately stepped off, and the man who actually slipped off the building. All of these men broke the law of gravity, and death was inevitable for all of them. It is the fact, you see, and not the degree. It is the fact that they were over the edge. They all broke the law of gravity. The question is, can the law of gravity which took them down to death give them life? And it cannot. The Mosaic law cannot give you life any more than that natural law can give you life after you have broken it and died. You cannot reverse the situation and come back from the street below to the top of the building and live, as it's done in a movie played backwards. Death follows wherever sin comes. The law of sin knows nothing of extenuating circumstances. It knows nothing about mercy. It has no elasticity. It is inflexible, inexorable, and immutable. God's word says, "The soul that sinneth, it shall die." To Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, God said, "But of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat of it, for in that day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die." Then in Exodus 34:7, he says that he will by no means clear the guilty. Now I want you to understand that, because we pass over that all the time. We have all kinds of people running around in all kinds of churches and denominations with this idea that somehow God's going to clear the guilty, when in fact, in Exodus 34, it says God is not going to clear the guilty, which means because he brought Jesus Christ. Therefore, all have sinned, and by the law we are all dead. The law slew us. It is called by Paul a ministration of death. It is a ministration of condemnation. The law condemns all of us. Can the law bring life? The law can no more bring life than a fall from a high roof can bring life to one who died by that fall. The purpose of the law was never to give life. It was given to show us that we are guilty sinners before God. Remember, you had one person stepped off the roof on purpose, one person slipped off by accident, and another one that was thrown off by someone else, right? Three different degrees. But they were all dead at the bottom. Now, I know that I'm going to hear somebody say, but that's not fair. Isn't that what we hear? That's not fair. But fairness didn't have anything to play with the fact that they're all dead at the bottom. That's the law. But before faith came, we were kept under the law, shut up unto the faith which would afterwards be revealed. Before faith came means, of course, faith in Jesus Christ who died for us. Until the Lord Jesus Christ came, the law had in it mercy because it had a mercy seat. It had an altar where sacrifices for sins could be brought and forgiveness could be obtained. Mercy could be found there. All the sacrifices for sins pointed to Christ. Before faith came, Paul says, we were kept under the law, shut up unto the faith which should afterwards be revealed. Wherefore, the law was our schoolmaster to bring us unto Christ that we might be justified by faith. This is a remarkable section. Paul is making it very clear here that the Mosaic law could not save. Romans 4:5 tells us, but to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly. His faith is counted for righteousness. God refused to accept the works of man for salvation. Remember, in the garden, God refused to accept Adam and Eve's covering and went and created a covering from animal skins. God says that all our righteousness are as filthy rags. God refuses to accept law keeping. The law cannot save. It can only condemn. It was not given to save sinners, but to let them know that they were sinners. The law does not remove sin. It reveals sin. It will not keep you from sin, because sin has already come. The law shows that man is not the way Hollywood portrays him, a sophisticated, refined, trained sinner. Man is actually an ugly sinner in the wrong. I want to use a homely illustration that I think might be helpful. I am confident that almost everyone has a bathroom. And in that bathroom is a wash basin with a mirror above it. That wash basin serves a purpose, and so does the mirror. When you get dirt on your face and you go to the bathroom to remove it, now you don't use the mirror to remove the dirt. If you see a smudge spot on your face and you lean over and rub your face against the mirror and one of your loved ones sees you, he will call a psychiatrist and make an appointment to find out what's wrong with you. But that won't happen because none of us is silly enough to try to remove the dirt with the mirror. Today, however, multitudes of people in our churches are rubbing up against the mirror of the law, thinking they are going to remove their sin. The Word of God is a mirror which shows us that we are what we are and who we are, that we are sinners and that we have come short of the glory of God. That is what the law reveals. But thank God, beneath the mirror, there is a basin. As the hymn writer puts it, there is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins. And sinners plunge beneath that flood, lose all their guilty stains. William Cowper, that is where you remove the spot. It is the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ that cleanses. The law proves man to be a sinner. It never makes him a saint. The law was given, as Paul says in Romans, that every mouth should be stopped and the whole world become guilty before God. Wherefore the law was our schoolmaster, Paul says. Now he will go on to tell us what he means by this. But after that, faith has come. We are no longer under a schoolmaster. Schoolmaster is a Greek in the Greek. And that's the thing that we have to go back to the original words, right? Because we change them as time goes. But the original word was pedagogus in Greek. And it doesn't mean school teacher, but it means schoolmaster is a good word. But it meant something quite different back in the days of Paul. It meant a servant or a slave who was part of the Roman household. Half the Roman Empire were slaves. There was 120 million Romans, or 120 million population at the time. 60 million of them were slaves. In the home of patricians, a member of the Praetorian Guard, or the rich in the Roman Empire, were slaves that cared for their children. When a child was born into such a home, he was put in the custody of a servant or a slave who actually raised him. He put clean clothes on him, bathed him, blew his nose when it was necessary, and disciplined him when he needed it. When the little one grew to a certain age and was to start to school, this servant was the one who got him up in the morning, dressed him, and took him to the school. That is where he got the name of pedagogus. Paid was to do with the feet, and we get our word pedal from it. Agogos means to lead. It means that he takes the little one by the hand, leads him to school, and turns him over to the school teacher. This servant, the slave, was not capable of teaching him beyond a certain age. So he took him to school. Now, what Paul is saying here is that the law is our pedagogos. The law said, little fellow, I can't do any more for you. I now want to take you by the hand and bring you to the cross of Christ. You see, you are lost. You need a Savior. The purpose of the law is to bring men to Christ, not to give them an expanded chest so they can walk around claiming they keep the law. You know, you don't keep the law. All you have to do is examine your own heart to know that none of us, no one, can keep the law. For ye are all children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. Paul is going to show in the remainder of this chapter and in the first part of chapter 4 some of the benefits that come to us by trusting Christ that we could never receive under the law. The law never could give a believer the nature of a son of God. Christ can do that. Only faith in Christ can make us sons of God. In this verse, the word children is from the Greek huos, meaning sons. Only faith in Christ can make us legitimate sons of God. I use the word legitimate for emphasis because the only sons of God are legitimate sons of God. You are made a true son of God by faith in Jesus Christ. And that is all it takes. Not faith plus something equals salvation. Remember, this is what the theme of Paul's Galatians is. Faith plus what? Faith plus nothing makes you a son of God. Nothing else can make you a son of God, for you're all sons of God. How? By faith in Jesus Christ. An individual Israelite under the law in the Old Testament was never a son, only a servant. These are good examples, because God called the nation Israel my son. But the individuals in that corporate nation were never called a son. He was called a servant of Jehovah. For example, Moses on the very was at very intimate terms with God. Yet God said of him, "Moses is my servant." Is dead. That is his epitaph. Also, although David was a man after God's own heart, God calls him David, my servant. Even if you keep the law, which you could not do, your righteousness would still be inferior to the righteousness of God. Sonship requires his righteousness, you see. The New Testament definitely tells us, but as many as receive him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. We are given the power to become the sons of God by doing no more nor less than simply trusting him. A Pharisee by the name of Nicodemus, you remember Nicodemus? He was religious to his fingertips, followed the law meticulously, yet he was not a son of God. And Jesus had to say to him that ye must be born again. I want to be dogmatic and very plain. Neither your prayers, your fundamental separation, your gifts, nor your baptism will ever make you a son of God. Only faith in Christ can make you a son of God. The most damnable heresy today is the universal fatherhood of God and the universal brotherhood of man. It is this teaching of liberalism that has caused this nation to give away billions of dollars through the world, and because of it, we are hated by everyone. All people are the children of God, they say. And so we sit in council tables and have engage in diplomatic squabbles with some of the biggest bad guys in the world. We all talk about being honest and honorable, that we are all the children of God and we must act like sons of God. Well, the Lord Jesus Christ never said anything like that. He once looked at a group of religious leaders and said to them, ye are of your father the devil, and the lusts of your father ye will do. I think the devil still has a lot of children running around in the world today. There are a lot of sons of God. The only way you can become a son of God is through faith in Jesus Christ. For as many of you have been baptized in Christ, have put on Christ. I hope you realize that this verse is not a reference to water baptism. Water baptism is ritual baptism. If you have accepted Jesus Christ and have made Him Lord of your life, God sees you in Christ. Therefore, He sees you as perfect. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither bond nor free. There is neither male nor female, for ye are all one in Christ Jesus. As any man in Christ is my brother, and I don't care about the color of his skin. It is the color of his heart that interests me. There are a lot of white people walking around with black hearts, and they are not my brother. It is only in Christ Jesus that we are made one. And if ye be Christ, then ye are Abraham's seed, and heirs according to the promise God made. How can we be Abraham's descendant? Because of the fact that Abraham was saved by faith, and we are saved by faith. Abraham brought a little animal to sacrifice, which looked forward to the coming of the Son of God, the supreme sacrifice. In our day, Christ has already come, and I can look back in history and say, almost 2,000 years ago, the Son of God came and died on the cross for me that I might have life, and I trust Him. By that faith alone, I become a son of God and an heir to Abraham. And I want you watching at home to understand that. That is the only way. Our hymn of dedication, "There is a fountain filled with blood."